Namaskar. I, Dr. Kapil Sharma, currently working as reader at Institute of Management Studies, Devi Ahilya University, Indore. In the area of finance, in this session, we'll focus on implementing choice-based credit system. Dear friends, UGC has initiated number of measures from time to time for bringing efficiency and equity and excellence in higher education system of our country. These measures have led to increase in the level of quality of higher education in our country. But due to lot of diversity, there exist multiple approaches towards the entire system. Keeping the academic and administrative autonomy of higher education institutes intact, there is a need to devise a much better teaching and learning evaluation system, which is in line with the international standards. For this, UGC has asked all higher educational institutes to adopt choice-based credit system. Before I move on to detailed explanation of CBCS, it is necessary to look at the benefits of the and deficiencies of the current education system. Today's education system is highly teacher-centric and has very little scope for the learner. From content to pace, everything is decided keeping in mind the capabilities and thought process of a teacher. A learner's participation in terms of what is to be taught, how it is to be taught, when it is to be taught, and how evaluation will be done, all is absent in this approach. Interest and capabilities of a student do not find place in the system, and all students are subjected to similar type of teaching learning processes. This has led to rat race and herd mentality among students. As today, students focus on replicating the success stories of past, forgetting the fact that environment is very dynamic and things may not be the same as they were in past. Another major deficiency is linking of education to job. Keeping aside the core essence of education, that is knowledge creation, skill development and value inculcation. Today's students have very little choice in terms of selecting their subjects after opting for a particular program or degree. Friends, it is like a hostel mess where one has to eat only what is served, unlike a hotel where one has the option to select what one wants to eat. Moreover, there is a total lack of interdisciplinary movement in terms of courses and in terms of program. For example, a student of engineering has no scope for inputs on history or geography or management, etc. in his curriculum. The same is true for others disciplines. Today, teaching learning is confined in classroom with overemphasis on managing up the theory. There is very little scope for group work, data collection, field work, practicals, projects, etc. In order to overcome these problems, UGC has asked all higher educational institutes to implement a credit-based choice system. The question rises, why CBCS? Many of you must be thinking, why we should have CBCS? What is the advantage of this? Well, let me highlight a few prominent advantages of CBCS, which will help you better understand this concept and system. First and foremost, the most important benefit, according to me, is that it is a more student-centric approach rather than a teacher-centric approach. Well, in CBCS, it is a student who is at the focal point and the entire pedagogy, curriculum, material, evaluation, etc. is designed keeping him at the center. Another major advantage is that it allows a student to decide upon his own pace of learning, deciding upon his capabilities and priorities. Here, the student has the choice to select what he wants to learn and from a range of electives. This helps a student to take up additional courses which can enhance his employability and skills. Further, the system specifies maximum number of credits to be taken in a minimum duration of time to complete a particular course or a program. There is no minimum time duration to complete a course. Hence, a fast learner can take more credits in each semester and complete the course earlier. CBC has one more advantage for students, which is it allows interdisciplinary curriculum and further permits transfer of credits from one institute to another. For example, if a full-time student pursuing MBA from X university is interested in studying, let's say, a subject, classical music, which is not taught in his university, but it is taught in a university Y, which carries 3 credits, then the student has the choice to enroll himself for classical music in Y university. And on successful completion, 3 credits earned by him at Y university will be transferred to X university. And this will be taken into consideration while preparing his result at X university. Now, let me discuss the important components of CBCS and ways to implement them. The components on which CBCS is based: types of courses, credit system, semester system, comprehensive and continuous assessment, and grading system. Let me explain the types of courses first. Although there are various types of classification of courses, but here I will focus on only those which are widely used and discussed. First of all, a core course. It is a course which is to be compulsorily studied by a student to complete the requirement of a program in a said discipline of study. For example, a core course in an MBA program aims to provide holistic approach towards management, giving students both an overview of the field and basis of specialization. A wider range of courses construct groundwork for management discipline such as accounting, marketing, finance, information system, organizational behavior, human resource, statistics, etc. This integrated foundation helps students to explore career options and expand their understanding. Next category of courses are elective courses. It is a course which one can choose from a pool of courses and which are very specific, advanced, or supportive to the discipline or subject of the study. These courses provide an extended scope which enables exposure to some other discipline, subject, domain, and which further nurtures careers, candidates, proficiency. Elective courses can be further classified into 2 categories, discipline specific electives and generic electives. Let me first talk about discipline specific electives. These are courses which may be offered by the main discipline or subject of study. An institute may also offer discipline related elective courses to interdisciplinary nature also. Moving on to generic elective courses, these are those elective courses which are generally chosen from an unrelated discipline or subject with an intention to seek exposure into that discipline. Another important component in CBCS is credit system. Now, I will give you a brief understanding of what is a credit system. Let us first look at the meaning of credit. A credit means a unit by which a course is measured. It determines the number of hours of instructions required per week for a particular course or a subject. Here, it is to be understood that 1 credit is equivalent to 1 hour of classroom teaching or 2 hours of practical or field work per week. So, if a course has 3 credits, it means that there will be 3 hours of classroom teaching or 6 hours of practical work for that course in a week. AICT credit requirements for an MBA program is 54 credits of core courses, 42 credits of electives, and 6 credits for internship or field work. Thus, the minimum number of credits for award of MBA degree as per AICT is 102 credits. However, institutes can offer higher number of credits but not less than 102 credits. Generally, in management, it is conventional to assign 4 credits to core courses and 3 credits to elective courses. However, lower or higher credits may be assigned to a particular course or a subject depending upon its requirement. Here it is to be noted that it is mandatory for all students to earn a minimum number of credits in each semester, which is decided by the institute or the university in order to move to the next level. In case a student fails to do so, then the student will not be promoted to the next level. Let's say a university offers 24 credits in his first semester of MBA program and requires a minimum of 18 credits to move to the next semester. If a student earns only 18 credits in the first semester, then the students will be required to move towards the next semester only when he chooses that in the next semester he will take the additional 6 credits to complete the requirement of the previous semester also. CBCS has one more important feature, that is, it allows carry forward of successfully earned credits to subsequent semesters. Suppose a student fails to secure minimum required number of credits in his first and second semester, and he wants to restart the 2 semesters again. Then the student's credits earned earlier will be carried over and the student will have to earn the balance number of credits required to complete the minimum requirement of credits. The next step in implementing CBCS is adopting semester system at all levels, as semester system is more suited for CBCS than the annual system. Friends, we all know annual system of teaching, learning and evaluation is not student oriented. The problem in it is that it generalizes the diversified needs and realities of the students. And the student is that all the students are treated at the similar manner, ignoring their individual needs and capabilities. CBCS is highly student centric in teaching and learning. The beauty of semester is that it provides high degree of flexibility to a teacher, which is in terms of designing a course or a program. Further, it enables continuous interaction between the teacher and student, thereby giving a regular face-to-face assessment of the student. Adopting semester system coupled with CBCS is the right move towards enhancing the level of higher education in our country. Friends, for getting best results of semester system, it is essential to adopt comprehensive continuous assessment. Hence, the next measure that is required in CBCS is adopting comprehensive continuous assessment. Universities should do away with their annual system of assessing the students. Comprehensive continuous assessment is the need of hour, as it looks at the students' overall capabilities in the form of regular assignments, which is a mix of various evaluation tools such as tests, quiz, presentations, assignments, group works, exercises, etc. This allows the student to constantly and continuously demonstrate their level of knowledge and also identify areas where improvement is required. Further, it allows teachers also to evaluate the effectiveness of their teaching strategies and modify them so as to include remedial activities for the students who are not performing as per the expectation. Under CBCS, and semester system, responsibility of assessing or evaluating the students for a particular course lies on the faculty who is teaching that course or a subject. It is to be observed that majority of institutes where CBCS is adopted use two-tier evaluations comprising of continuous assessment and an end semester examination. Continuous assessment throughout the semester varies between 40% to 50% of the total marks, and the teaching faculty is given the autonomy to decide upon the components of this assessment and their weightages. The end semester examination generally carries weightage which is between 50% to 60% of the total marks. Here also, the teaching faculty has the full liberty to decide upon the structure or the pattern of the examination. As far as passing criteria is concerned, majority of the institutes follow passing marks to be between 35% to 40%. However, there exists as to difference in arriving upon the passing marks. Many institutes follow individual passing in both continuous assessment as well as end semester examination, whereas a large number of institutes follow overall passing criteria, that is, summing up of the marks obtained in continuous assessment and the marks obtained in end semester examinations to arrive at the passing criteria. Higher education institutes are currently following various methods of declaring results. Traditionally, teacher awards marks to the students based on its performance in the examination, and these marks are then used to calculate percentage. This is a very old and widely used method. But under CBCS, marks given by the teacher are converted into a letter grades, where each letter grade corresponds to a grade point. Let's take an example. As per the grading system of a institute, if a student scores marks which lies between 112 to 113, he will get A plus grade, where the corresponding grade point of A plus is 9. Let's say a student has secured 128 marks, then he gets an A plus grade with a corresponding grade of 9, where maximum grade point is 10. Here, it is to be noted that all students who secure marks between 112 and 134 will get A plus grade. This eliminates the difference between the performance of all those students who secure marks between 112 to 134 and puts them all at the same level. Now, let me talk about ways to convert marks into grades. There are two methods to convert marks into grades. They are relative method and absolute method. In relative grading, the method is based upon normal distribution of marks obtained by all the students in a particular course, and the grades are awarded based on a cutoff mark or percentile. Whereas, under the absolute grading system, marks are converted into letter grades based on predetermined class intervals of marks. In our example, we have used absolute grading system. Friends, unlike traditional methods where percentage is used as a composite way of expressing the result of a student for a particular semester or year, CBCS follows the concept of calculating semester grade point average, SGPA. Now, to calculate SGPA, one must know the credits allotted to each subject. These credits are usually mentioned on the syllabus. To understand it better, let us take an example. Say in a semester, there are 6 courses and each course carries a certain number of credits. Like course 1 is of 3 credits, course 2 is of 4 credits, and so on. In our example, we see that the total credits of the course is 20. Let's say a student obtained A grade in course 1 with a corresponding grade point of 8. Now, his grade point of that course, that is 8, will be multiplied with the credit allotted to that subject, that is C3, which makes the resultant 24 for that course. Similarly, it will be done for all the courses. Now, the next step is to add upon the product of grade point and subject grade point for all the courses. In our example, this sum is 139, which is very much similar to the weighted arithmetic mean, where grade point, credit point is equivalent to weightages. Now, in order to arrive at SGPA, the sum of product of subject credit point and grade point is divided by sum of credit of all the courses. In our case, it is 139 divided by 20, which is 6.9. Hence, the SGPA of the student is 6.9 for that particular semester. Friends, CBCS uses cumulative grade point average to express the overall result of a student in a particular program. Let me now explain to you how to calculate CGPA. It is a ratio where numerator is the sum of product of SGPA and its corresponding total credits of that particular semester. In our example, for semester 1, it is 6.9 multiplied by 20, plus for semester 2, it is 7.8 multiplied by 22, and so on. The denominator here is the sum of credits of the entire program. In our case, it is 144. Thus, the value of cumulative grade point average is 6.73, which is the overall result of the student in a particular program. Although CBCS seems to be very promising in elevating the quality of higher education, but like any other system, it too needs to address certain issues. First and foremost is the issue of scarcity of qualified teachers and supporting staff in institutes. Implementation of CBCS will require more teachers, as the number of courses or subjects to be offered under electives will increase. And in the absence of well-qualified teachers and supporting staff, the true essence of CBCS will be lost somewhere. CBCS will lead to increase in the workload of teachers multifold. Most of the time, they may end up preparing different assessments and evaluating them. This will result into lesser time for class preparation and research. Mobility of students from one institute to another institute also may pose lots of problems, as there exist lot of difference between central university, state university and colleges in terms of efficient teachers, academic environment, infrastructure, etc. Dear friends, CBCS requires students to be highly informed and updated, as in the absence of it, maintaining compatibility between main subject courses and other courses would be challenging. It is possible that some students may end up taking courses which at the end of the day do not help them in their career path. Since a teacher will be responsible for the entire course, starting from the designing of the course, teaching it, setting up of question papers and evaluation, many people argue that this would vest too much powers in the hands of teachers and which is subject to misuse. Hence, there is a need for mechanism to ensure proper checks, balances and transparency into the entire system. In the end, I would like to say that undoubtedly CBCS would cast positive impact on the higher education system of our country. But India is a giant country in terms of education system. Higher education is very complex because it houses different nature of courses and streams. However, it has been assumed that implementation of CBCS will bring uniformity in the entire education system through uniform teaching and evaluation systems. Flexibility in choosing credits, opting different courses, mobility of students are some of the major features of CBCS which will bring our higher education system in line with the developed nations. But MHRD, UGC and other bodies should not go in haste while implementing CBCS. It will be better if policy makers discuss and debate the basic nuances of CBCS and its implementation in the broader perspective, taking into consideration the size and variety of our higher education. It will be wise if institutions are given a time frame to implement the system. This will definitely help them train their faculty members, procure required resources, and place in new systems which is required for the success of this system. With these words, I put an end to this session. I hope you will find it very fruitful. Thank you and Jai Hind.